Please join me in our call to worship. How lovely is your dwelling place, O God! With joy and gladness, let us gather for worship. Laying down burdens and cares, your people rest in your holy presence. With prayer and song, we will praise you forever and ever.
Hear now today's prayer of the day. O God, our Creator and Sustainer, in you we live and move and have our being. Guide us in your ways by the power of your Holy Spirit, so that our words and actions reflect your love as we step forward in faith to answer your call. This we pray through Christ our Savior. Amen.
I invite you to join with me in praying our prayer of confession. Let us pray. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways. To the glory of your name, amen. Now let us take a moment for our own silent confessions. The good news is that Christ calls us to new life, enables us to begin again and again and again. Amen.
Please pray with me. O God, who is gracious and merciful, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love, we come to you in prayer. For the Church Universal and our Knollwood congregation, that we would speak and act in the ways of justice and peace. For the nations of the world and for all those in authority, that hard hearts would soften and wisdom would prevail. For all who are oppressed or in prison, that captives of body or spirit would be set free. For those struggling with illness, anxiety, or unemployment in the midst of the pandemic, for this moment of racial justice reckoning in our country, that inequity would transform into truly one nation for all. For the health of those who suffer in mind, body, or spirit, that a provision of healing would be given. For each of us, as we do our best with what we have and what we know, and serve you with what we have been given. O God, who is good, whose compassion covers all, hear our prayer. Amen.
Was heavy. Whew, I think I may have packed too much. You know, there's a time, not right now at least, whenever we used to travel places. You used to pack a bag, right? You'd grab a suitcase like this one. Nope, can't pick it up. Like this one that you can't see. And we would stuff things in it. We would put clothes and sunscreen and more clothes and a towel and more clothes and shampoo and more clothes and just a lot of clothes, really. We would put all the stuff in our bag and we would zip it up, and if you were flying somewhere you had to weigh it, but if you were just driving in a car, your dad would pick it up and just throw it in the back of the car and you would be ready to go and you would travel. They were always so heavy. Like, this bag is so heavy. Heavy bags. You know, in a minute you're gonna hear some instructions that Jesus gives some of his followers, and he talks about heavy burdens. He says, if you're tired, if you're having a hard time carrying the things that you're carrying, let me help you. And Jesus likes to help. Jesus likes to help us, especially whenever we're carrying things that are too heavy for us. Can you think of something that you're carrying that's heavy? It could be a relationship. It could be a friendship that may not be going very well. It could be a sadness with a family member or a sickness. It could just be just a general bummed outness. This can be heavy bags. It can be heavy for us to carry them on our own. But Jesus tells us, if you're tired, if you need some help, if you need someone to help carry that bag with you, to help carry that burden, carry mine and I'll carry yours. Mine is light, Jesus says, and let me help you carry the heavy one. What can you think about that you could let Jesus help you carry? What could you ask Jesus to help you carry from day to day?
Our Old Testament lesson for today is from Genesis 24. I came today to the spring and said, O Lord, the God of my master Abraham, if now you will only make successful the way I am going. I am standing here by the spring of water. Let the young woman who comes out to draw, to whom I shall say, please give me a little water from your jar to drink, and who will say to me, drink, and I will draw for your camels also. Let her be the woman whom the Lord has appointed for my master's son. Before I had finished speaking in my heart, there was Rebekah coming out with her water jar on her shoulder, and she went down to the spring and drew. I said to her, please let me drink. She quickly let down her jar from her shoulder and said, drink, and I will also water your camels. So I drank, and she also watered the camels. Then I asked her, "Whose daughter are you?" She said, "The daughter of Bethuel, Nahor's son, whom Milcah bore to him." So I put the ring on her nose and the bracelets on her arms. Then I bowed my head and worshiped the Lord and blessed the Lord, the God of my master Abraham, who had led me by the right way to obtain the daughter of my master's kinsman for his son. Now then, if you will deal loyally and truly with my master, tell me. And if not, tell me, so that I may turn either to the right hand or to the left. This is the word of God. Thanks be to God.
Our second lesson continues chapter 24 through verses 56 through 67. But he said to them, "Do not delay me, since the Lord has made my journey successful. Let me go that I may go to my master." They said, "We will call the girl and ask her." And they called Rebekah and said to her, "Will you go with this man?" She said, "I will." So they sent away their sister Rebekah and her nurse along with Abraham's servant and his men. And they blessed Rebekah and said to her, "May you, our sister, become thousands of myriads. May your offspring gain possession of the gates of their foes." Then Rebekah and her maids rose up, mounted the camels, and followed the man. Thus the servant took Rebekah and went his way. Now Isaac had come from Beer Lahai Roi and was settled in the Negev. Isaac went out in the evening to walk in the field, and looking up, he saw camels coming. And Rebekah looked up, and when she saw Isaac, she slipped quickly from the camel and said to the servant, "Who is the man over there, walking in the field to meet us?" The servant said, "It is my master." So she took her veil and covered herself. And the servant told Isaac all the things that he had done. Then Isaac brought her into his mother Sarah's tent. He took Rebekah, and she became his wife, and he loved her. So Isaac was comforted after his mother's death. This is the word of God. Thanks be to God.
Hear these words from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 11. Then Jesus said, "Come to me, all you who are weary and carry heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you. Let me teach you, because I am humble and gentle at heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy to bear, and the burden I give you is light." This is the gospel of Christ. Thanks be to God.
One cold, wintry evening, an elderly man was driving down a lonely stretch of road in New England. His car stalled and he glided off the road onto a narrow shoulder that happened to be atop a rocky hill. While getting out of the car, he slipped and fell down the craggy slope. At the bottom of the hill, faint and in severe pain, he was unable to move. With night falling and few travelers passing by, his chances of rescue were slim. He'd almost certainly die of exposure before morning. 3 hours later, as the man faded in and out of consciousness, a passing college student driving by happened to catch him in his headlights. The student came to the man's aid, warmed him by covering him with his jacket, managed to get him up the hill, into the car, and to the hospital. Once the student knew the man was in good hands, he disappeared into the night without a word. Later, the only thing the hospital personnel could tell the elderly gentleman about his rescuer was that he had a college jacket with the word Providence lettered across the back. Forever after, the old gentleman would confess, "You'll never convince me that fellow was just connected with a university in Rhode Island." The theme of providence is woven throughout the stories of Genesis. But today's story is rather unique in that genre, because in this story, the longest story in Genesis, the story of Abraham's servant finding Isaac a wife, there is no dramatic divine appearance, no angels, no miracles. God doesn't even have a speaking part. In other words, this story is a lot more like our stories than most stories in the Bible. And maybe that's the point, that God's gracious guiding hand is present, not just in the big epic events of history, but in our most ordinary of days. The story begins with Abraham commissioning his servant to find a suitable wife for his son Isaac. Old man Abraham can't have Isaac marrying one of the local Canaanite gals, for they might turn his heart from fervent devotion to Yahweh, the Lord of the covenant. So Abraham sends his most trusted servant, Eleazar, back to the land of Abraham's birth. The servant is not named in the story, but rabbinic tradition has dubbed him Eleazar, so we'll use that name here. Eleazar sets off on a dangerous mission of several hundred miles, finally landing at a well in what is today southeastern Turkey. Then he prays, earnestly, hopefully, that the first young woman coming to the well will not only offer water to him, but will offer to water his camels as well. And if that happens, he'll know this is the one God has selected for Isaac. Well, as soon as he finishes his prayer, a young, beautiful Rebecca appears. And seeing the weary stranger at the well, she offers him water and then graciously offers to water his camels. In a dramatic touch, the Bible says that Eleazar gazed at her in silence to learn whether the Lord had made his journey successful. Then when he learns that Rebekah belongs to Abraham's family, he knows his prayers have been answered. Now, of course, all of that could have just been a coincidence, one of those random twists of fates that dot our days. But as a man of faith and devotion, Eleazar believes that something else, something more is going on, and someone else is unseen but present. Sometimes such hints of God's unseen but gracious guiding hand surprise us as well. A desperately needed job appears out of nowhere. A deeply felt tug in your heart opens up to an unexpected opportunity for service. A Bible verse you just happened upon suddenly pulses with light and meaning as though it were put there just for you. A chance meeting with an old colleague puts your life on a whole new path. Some people call moments like these, when we are surprised by God's mysterious presence and movements, God winks. God winks awaken us to the realization that the living God is near. A while back, I got a remarkable God wink story sent to me by a member of our church. A lingering grief over the death of this woman's mother hung heavy on her heart. She forced herself to go to Sunday school that day, but again, she was absorbed in grief and self-preoccupied. For that Sunday of that Sunday school class, of that immense grief, happened to be her mother's birthday. She sat through the class as best she could, a class on the epiphany of Jesus and all the ways God surprises us and shows up in Scripture and sometimes in life. Then at the close of the class, which frankly couldn't come soon enough for her, the teacher read a poem. And as the teacher read the beloved words from Robert Frost, "Stopping by a Wood on a Snowy Evening," this sister sat there quietly weeping, because that poem was her mother's favorite. That Robert Frost poem was found in her mother's pocketbook after her death. Now, hearing those words anew, at this poignant moment, amid her tears, our sister had the distinct impression that not only her mother, but the one who now held her mother in the everlasting arms, had drawn near. I know some would call it a coincidence, but believers in the God of Abraham and Isaac and Jacob, and the God and Abba of our Lord Jesus Christ, know better. They know, as someone has said, that coincidences are God's way of remaining anonymous. And yet the surprising providence of God is only the first half of the story. The other half is Eleazar's and Rebekah's remarkable obedience to God's call and willingness to partner with God in God's purposes. For while God is the unseen actor in the story, both Eleazar and Rebekah play pivotal roles. Eleazar acts in faith by making that long, demanding journey with no promise of success, fueled by nothing but his faith and hope and courage. And when it comes time to negotiate the bride's dowry, he nimbly negotiates with the wily Laban. But far more importantly, Rebekah emerges as an Abraham figure in the story, not only because of her radical hospitality like that of her future father-in-law, but because when God says go, she goes. Like Abraham before her in that very place, long years before, she answers the call to go chasing after a largely unknown, but mysterious, faithful, merciful God. So too in our place and time, we're not called to be mere spectators of God's winks. We're called to be God's partners in what our Jewish friends call the tikkun olam, the work of repairing the world. Right now, for example, our God is looking for allies, especially white allies, to join our brown and black African American Latino brothers and sisters in their struggle for respect and a fair shake and justice for all. Right now, God is looking for partners willing to wear a mask when needed in order to beat back a deadly pandemic. Right now, God is looking for servants to do their part to keep our church vital and strong during this strange, unsettling season of being mostly homebound in a mostly virtual world. There are so many ways our God is inviting us to join God in the great work of life and liberation and healing. In short, as my friend Kay Sheridan often says, God doesn't need any more dependents. What God needs are partners. And so God winks and calls us into companionship and pilgrimage and service. Then it falls to us to answer, like Abraham and Eleazar and Rebekah of old, with all the faith and courage we can muster. Imagine a dream where you are examining the footprints left behind after you and Jesus take a long walk on the beach. Jesus' footprints are steady and true, but yours are a disorganized mess of starts and stops, wandering this way and then that. Then in the next phase of the journey, the next stretch of beach, there's a change in the tracks. Your footprints disappear altogether, and only Jesus' footprints are visible in the sand. Finally, in the third stretch of the beach, your footprints are back. And once more, the zigzagging returns, along with countless starts and stops and twists and turns in the sand. Mystified, you turn to Christ in prayer. Lord, I understand the zigzags at the start. That's when I was first learning to walk with you. That's right, says Jesus. And when my footprints disappeared, that's when I learned to follow you more closely. Our footprints merged as I walked in your steps. Right again, says Jesus. But what I don't understand, you say in bewilderment and some pain, is why our footprints separated again. Once more, there were all those starts and stops, twists and turns, only this time more pronounced than ever. What was that all about? A whimsical smile crosses Jesus' face as he answers, "That's when we danced." When the mysterious, unseen, but ever faithful God offers you an invitation, a call to service, to join God in the great work of repairing the world, when God offers you the divine hand, take it and dance. Pray with me. Our good and gracious and ever faithful God, help us trust you more that we might worry less, knowing that you will continue to surprise us, continue to show up, to lead and sustain and guide. In Jesus' name, we pray and claim that promise. Amen.
In Acts we read, "In everything I did, I showed you that by this kind of hard work, we must help the weak, remembering the words the Lord Jesus himself said, "It is more blessed to give than to receive." Let us pray. Gracious God, we humbly approach you, asking for wisdom and guidance as we journey through this time of fear and uncertainty. We acknowledge that everything we have comes from you and belongs to you. You have richly blessed us with your steadfast love and grace. Out of our gratitude, please accept our gifts of service, caring, prayer, and when possible, money, for the building of your kingdom on earth. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
I hope you're enjoying a wonderful holiday weekend celebrating our nation's independence. Yes, as we have learned anew of late, there's still a lot of work to do, but also so much to be grateful for, to call America our home. And so we sing our prayer, "America, America, God, shed thy grace on thee," but also, "America, America, God, mend thine every flaw." But I am so grateful to be part of a nation that, in the words of Lincoln, will be a government of the people, by the people, and for the people. Pray God it never perishes from upon the earth. I want to welcome Lynn Wood and Ann Rich as new members of our church. Lynn Wood just retired as a furniture executive, but then in retirement took a new gig at Vanguard Furniture in Hickory in sales management. Apparently he loves what he does. As did and does his wife, Ann, who spent 21 years as a school librarian at Louisville Elementary. Linwood and Ann have 3 children and 4 grandchildren. 2 of those grandchildren are twin granddaughters who attend Knollwoods Through the Week School. Linwood and Ted Philpott go back to Wake Forest days together and are lifelong friends. The Riches come to us from a sister church in our city. Linwood and Ann, we welcome you into this fellowship and look forward to coming to know and love you better. Go now, dear brothers and sisters, always remembering that you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy people, God's own partners, in proclaiming the mighty acts of the one who called you out of darkness into our Lord's marvelous light. Amen.